everybody. Thank you so much for coming. This is the Local History Local Novelist series, and I'm Susan Stinson. I'm writer in residence here at Forbes Library. And tonight, this is the second reading in this series, and I want to let you know that the, there's flyers for the series and also for the next reading over on the glass case if you want to pick them up as you go. And the next reading is it echoing? Is there something funny happening with the sound? Can you hear okay?
Yeah,
they can hear okay. Okay. So the next reading in the series is a departure from what we usually do. It's December 4th, Hampshire County Memories. The Daily Hampshire Gazette is publishing a book of local photographs, and so Faith Kaufman and Dylan Gaffney from the library are going to talk about the photographs. And I think also Dan Shear, who's a local photographer, will be discussing them too. So that should be fun. But tonight, we have two wonderful novelists, Marisa Lapozetta and Karen Osborne. And just so I don't forget to say it, the premise of this series is that the depth and subtlety and passion with which we engage with history is in large part defined by the depth and subtlety and passion with which we engage with story, every kind of story. So tonight we're getting stories from Marisa Lapozetta and Karen Osborne. And we're going to start with Marisa. Marisa Lapozetta is the author of the collection of stories At the Copa, a John Gardner Fiction Book Award finalist and Pushcart Prize nominee. Link's stories, Thieves Never Steal in the Rain, the novel Stay With Me, Layla, and her most recent novel, Sometimes It Snows in America, a 2013 Eric Hoffer Award finalist. Many of these books have been pulled out of the collection, and they're on a table in the lobby downstairs. If you're interested in checking one out, they're easy to find right now. Her work has been appeared in numerous anthologies and literary journals, such as The American Voice, The Florida Review, American Fiction, When I Am an Old Woman, I Shall Wear Purple, Via, Italian Americana, Perigi, Beliefnet, and the Penguin Book of Italian American Writing. She's taught the Italian American experience at Smith College and the University of Massachusetts, writing at Kirtland Community College Controlled Burn Seminar for Writing. She is currently the guest editor for a special collection on loss, love, and the supernatural for the MDPI online journal Religions. She lives in Northampton, and we're so happy to have her to be with us tonight.
Yes, is that right? Thank you, Susan. Anything Susan says sounds good. So she should just read my work. I want her voice. Thank you for having me. Thank you for coming. I'm going to read from two of my latest works. I thought that would be the best thing, two different genres, a novel and one short story. I'll start with the novel, which came out just about this time last year, called Sometimes It Snows in America. This is a book inspired by a true story of a woman born to a Somali general and the Saudi mother, a descendant of royalty. In the time of the story takes place in the time of Siad Barre's ruthless regime in Somalia. She was her parents' 14th child. She's given away in infancy to her mother's infertile sister and British husband in Mombasa, Kenya, where she's raised. I think then I'll just read, gives you a little bit of background. It follows her life, I would say, for a period of 35 years. Her arrival in America is anything but a great ending. So let me begin. I'll begin at the beginning. Shelby House of Correction, 1995. The taxi and the ambulance showed up at the same time on the afternoon Fatma shot her husband. She had phoned for the taxi. He had summoned the ambulance that came accompanied by a squad car. If the taxi had arrived first, she might have got away. Shelby County Jail and House of Correction was color coordinated with uniforms that matched the cinder block walls of the cell blocks, a sea of greens and corals and purples and blues to tell the women that they'd become a category, newcomer, pretrial, troublemaker, or psycho. If they enlisted in the culinary school, they got to wear white. She arrived at the orientation cell block on a Thursday wearing tropical orange. The day hadn't mattered to her then, but she would come to hate Thursday. It was inspection day, the day that would remind her of Auntie's house in which she'd grown up and where the maids constantly scrubbed and polished. While Fatma sponged down the metal toilet and sink in her cell during the weeks and months that followed, she would close her eyes and wander back to that colonial mansion Uncle Oliver had built. She could get away from herself that way. Then she'd open her eyes and catch her distorted image in the wavy slab of shiny metal that hung above the sink. No glass was allowed at Shelby, nothing that might be used as a weapon or for self-destruction. And she'd remember that she and her life had become warped beyond recognition, that they'd become uglier than she had ever imagined they could be, that she had stumbled so far from home, so far from Mombasa. And I'm skipping up a little to a point some years later where she is betrothed. We are now in Kenya. Daniel Kornmeyer, the young man said, extending his hand, "Hujambo." He was standing in the large foyer surrounded by a hand-painted English country scene. Uncle Oliver had brought the wallpaper back to Mombasa from London as he had the many pieces of antique furniture in the house. Two staircases rose on either side of him, leading to the second floor balcony. Their ebony balusters and handrails had been carved by local Kenyans. Uncle Oliver clasped the hand firmly, jerking it downward and back up again in one motion. This was what he considered the only way to shake a man's hand, as though testing to see whether his greeter was virile enough to keep the hand from being snapped off. "Oliver Widdowson, Hujambo," he said. Daniel was as tall as the Englishman. This seemed to please Uncle Oliver. When Daniel removed his dripping army green plastic poncho, he revealed a body as skinny as paper, so thin he could be folded over and over again and put into someone's pocket for safekeeping, perhaps into his own narrow blue jeans. His hair was the color of weak tea, and tied back like a horse's tail, hung in one sopping coil down his back. He had what looked like the beginnings of a beard. Fatma would later realize that it was in fact a full beard, hard to make out because of its blonde color. But that would not be apparent until she became very close to him. So close, she could see the blue in his eyes and taste the curry on his lips. So close, she could see two eyelashes pasted together with sleep. "You cannot see her, you know," Oliver said. "Custom." "I know." No, he could not see Fatma, nor she him. But crouched on all fours, an ear pressed to a floorboard in the maid Leisha's room above, Fatma could hear him, and through a hole left by a missing sliver of wood, she could vaguely make out his image. By the time the meal was over, the arrangement had been made. The deal Oliver Widdowson had agreed to on a lark years before became reality. Daniel and Fatma were engaged. He was 19, she 11. And we'll skip to their wedding. In Kenya, all of the women of the village watched the bride intently on her wedding night, since it's common for fearful girls to run away from arranged marriages they're so young. The women escorted Fatma home from the celebration and waited in the hall, guarding the door while she readied herself for Daniel. Afterward, they would take her to the room where he was waiting and park themselves outside the door until the marriage was consummated and the midwife examined her one last time for traces of blood, evidence of her lost innocence. "I will not live with a white man," Fatma had boasted to friends, knowing that racial suspicion would make them more eager to help her escape. On her wedding night, Fatma removed the white gown and crown veil and put on men's clothing. Her friend Halima had given her the garments and she'd hidden them days before under her mattress. While the midwife prepared her bath, she parted the gauze curtains and climbed out the bedroom window, down an iron trellis abloom with red roses whose thorns caught on her clothing and scratched her. Halima's father, a fisherman, waited for Fatma on the shore in his dhow and ferried her to Somalia in the night. The waters between Mombasa and Somalia are rough, the current strong. It was 9 days later when they reached her birth mother's house in Mogadishu. Three of Fatma's older brothers, who had been in Mombasa for the wedding, but who, after her disappearance, had flown back to Somalia, were expecting her. There was no welcome or expression of surprise. They immediately began slapping and kicking her. Each time she fell, one of them picked her up and threw her back down again on the floor. Even her favorite brother, Hamal, joined in the beating. They were careful not to touch her face. They didn't want to give Daniel an excuse to reject her. Like the time she had to stifle her sobs when the soldiers came to her mother's home in the middle of the night, she now concealed the pain she felt all over her body, the hurt in her heart. And she believed that if her father, the general, had been in Mogadishu, her brothers would never have done what they did. While beatings were a part of the culture of Somali domestic life, her father had never laid a hand on her mother. After they finished with Fatma, her brother Hamal accompanied her back to Mombasa by plane. During the journey, Fatma refused to speak with him. Years would pass before she did so again. One would have thought Allah himself had knocked at Auntie's door for all the fuss made over Hamal for returning with Fatma. They celebrated with another feast. More determined than ever that night, Fatma escaped out the window again. In Mombasa, if you asked someone to keep a secret, they would. All her friends were on her side. The first time she ran away, no one thought to look for her in a fishing dhow. Fishermen were lower class, and she'd been forbidden to associate with them. But for that very reason, she was drawn to these people. This time, Hamal went to every boat in the harbor, yachts and dhows alike. By the time they came to the one in which Fatma had been hiding, the 18-wheel of food transporter she was on was headed for Uganda. There, the driver met with another, who took her to Tanzania. "So, princess, you want a ride?" the drivers had said when she climbed into their trucks, because everyone knew and respected her. She was the granddaughter of a Somali king and the great-granddaughter of the king before him. After Fatma had spent a week at a friend's house in Tanzania, the friend's mother had called Auntie, who came and escorted Fatma back to Mombasa. "You're angry with me, Mama?" Fatma asked as they sat on the airplane. Auntie liked it when she called her Mama. "What do you expect, Fatma, to show such disrespect to your uncle who has given you his home?" "Is he cross with me, Mama?" "Quite. I don't care." Fatma waited for some admonishment. Instead, Auntie turned toward the window, but not before Fatma saw her fighting a smile. So Auntie was not that upset with the runaway bride after all. Perhaps she was even enjoying their little trip, though Fatma's behavior had been an insult to her husband, whose honor Auntie was bound to uphold. This time, there were no festivities upon Fatma's return to Mombasa. The old women were called back to wait by the door, and after their first night together, Daniel and Fatma left for his post in Katundu. And let's get to it. She got used to Daniel. He was kind, and she trusted him, but she never grew to love him. And she would never get used to life in Katundu, nor did she try. She was stubborn that way. She could have sat in on Daniel's classes, but she refused to learn English, feeling her mother's fingers digging deep into her shoulders, shaking them until her head nearly toppled, warning her to keep away. Perhaps that's why she continued to wear a veil, even though she wore Western clothes in Katundu, where the days were long and boring, and where she spent most of her time planning her escape. She missed her family. She missed friends like Halima and the fun they'd had on the forbidden shore, where they used to jump from one dhow to another, playing hide and seek or screaming secrets that the deaf fishermen couldn't hear because their eardrums had burst from diving too deep for lobsters. Fatma missed her maid, Leisha, and the stories Leisha would tell her in her bedroom or the kitchen or laundry room when she thought Auntie wasn't listening. Yet when Daniel's commitment to the Peace Corps ended and he told her they would be going to the United States, she cried. She ran out of the house and was gone for hours. Daniel found her sobbing under a baobab. "Never walk under that type of tree when you are unclean," Leisha had always said. "Evil genes know when a woman is unclean and will enter her, possess her." She had her period that night, yet she lay beneath the baobab sobbing. Nothing worse could happen to her than what was about to. An evil spirit had entered her body at birth, according to Leisha. That must have been the gene that controlled her destiny. What else could it have been, she thought. It wasn't necessary to go to America. She told Daniel it was Katundu she had to leave, not Africa. But Daniel had renewed his 2-year commitment once already. Eyes filled with compassion, he cupped her wet face in his hands. "You will like it," he said, "I promise." The notion that she might like America was inconceivable. She was 15 and terrified that in America she would be lost. So now, I would like to shift gears completely and talk about some other immigrants. And this is I'm going to read an abridged short story from a collection of linked short stories, they're all a little blurry, called Thieves Never Steal in the Rain. This was published as an ebook 2 years ago, and it will be published in paperback by Guernica Editions, who has done my other books, but that won't be, probably for another year. Again, I said it's a collection of linked short stories about five cousins who are children of Italian immigrant men, five women. It's about their experience with love, loss, and the supernatural. And the main character, salut, Joanna, she's kind of the main character, even though it revolves around the five of them, the main character throughout the story. And she's been grappling with a recent loss of her daughter, passed away, and the effects on her marriage and her family relationships. So this is a story about Joanna and primarily her father. It's called Forecast for a Sunny Day. "Did you see him?" Marco Ficola asked his daughter. They sat side by side, separated by the contraptions engineers designed to shift gears and hold coffee cups and cigarette butts. "Who?" Joanna fastened her seatbelt and placed the key in the ignition. "The owner of the villa in Gronda. Did you see him when you were there last year?" Joanna began to maneuver out of her parking place. Her mother's face, chalky and seemingly more wrinkled than the day before, filled the rearview mirror. "Ma, can you move your head, please?" "What?" "Your head. Can you move it to one side? I can't see the car behind me." "What's she saying?" Myra Ficola asked her husband, as though Joanna was speaking a foreign language. "Take your hat off," Marco Ficola bellowed. She lost her hearing aid again. "What are you telling her?" Myra Ficola said in an equally loud voice. Joanna longed for a volume control button. "I don't know why you have to wear that damn huge hat all the time," Marco shouting had brought on a coughing fit. "I don't want to catch a chill. I read that you should always wear something on your head. That's where you lose most of your body heat. That's probably why you can't get rid of this thing you have. You never wear a hat. For crying out loud, Piovoso said it's going to be sunny, 60 degrees today." "Piovoso, what does he know?" "He's a meteorologist. He knows." "What does he know?" Marco said, mimicking his wife. There was a time when Joanna's mother would have told him to shut up and stop making fun of her. There was a time when he wouldn't have ridiculed her so much, when they operated on a more even playing field. But she could hardly hear now, and so he was free to vent all he liked, particularly when he had his back to her. She was shrinking a bit more each day and her voice becoming frailer. Joanna didn't know for whom to feel sorrier, her mother, who couldn't hear or remember what she'd eaten for lunch 5 minutes after she'd consumed it, or for an anxiety-ridden father whose patience had become tissue paper thin. "Joanna, I asked you if you saw him. You didn't answer me," her father said. "Dad, I don't even know who you're talking about." "Oh, come on, Joanna, don't play dumb. I told you about him." "You did?" "Of course, he was the owner of Villa Foresta." He tilted his head and shouted into the backseat, "Myra, remember Harlan Greenwood? Didn't he play for the Patriots?" "Myra, he was the owner of the villa we found the last time we were in Italy." "Oh, yes, the New Zealand man with a large wife. That's it." He was thrilled that she remembered. He would have kissed her had she not been sitting behind him. "Maybe you told Elliot about it," Joanna said, referring to her husband. "I told you." Maybe her father had. Maybe she was becoming like her mother, her life slowly getting caught between the slippery folds of her brain. She suddenly felt remorse for her own lack of tolerance. She quit talking to her parents, really talking. It just took too much effort. It was easier to phone the doctor herself or to send the thank you notes rather than explain to them what had to be done. She had been that way with her daughter, but Myra had told Joanna that if she didn't let Jill do things on her own, how was she to learn? Well, Joanna's parents didn't need to learn anymore, so why did she have to humor them? Time was running out for her, too. "I don't know why you always have to come with us to the doctor, Joanna," her mother said. "Your father's perfectly capable of driving." "Please stop interrupting, Myra. I'm trying to ask our daughter a question, but she keeps avoiding me." "I'm not avoiding you," Joanna was laughing now. "How could anyone avoid you, Dad?" This statement offended him. He knew it was not meant as a compliment, so he turned sullen, his body sinking into his car seat. It was a joke, Dad.
Yeah.
How are you feeling, Mr. Ficola? Dr. Adler asked, looking at not at Marco, but at his chart. I'm fine. I don't even know why I'm here. At my age, if you look for something, you're going to find it. I have a lot of symptoms. Comes with the territory. I told you, I'm good. Good to go. Dad, tell him about your cough and... I brought my mother, Marco said, interrupting Joanna, who sat with a notebook on her lap. The cough still keeping you up at night? Dr. Adler asked the chart. I get up so many times to go to the bathroom, I don't know which keeps me up. How about you give me another antibiotic? I can shake this thing. I licked typhoid fever during the war, I licked pneumonia last year, and I can lick this. You've already been on two antibiotics. That's why Dr. Mathis sent you to me. Enough of the chit-chat. What did my test show, doctor? Your CAT scan confirmed my suspicions. You have adenocarcinoma, and that's lung cancer. Dr. Adler said, without changing his expression or intonation. He said everything matter-of-factly, as though he were hooked up to an IV of ice water, most likely from the smoking. I quit 15 years ago. You smoke for 45. That last remark silenced the mighty Marco Ficola. Joanna had never seen her father at a loss for words, her eyes filled with disbelief. When they told him Joanna's daughter Jill had died, he'd broken down and wept and cursed God, but now confronting his own mortality, he sat in shock. Joanna decided they'd get a second opinion. She didn't like Dr. Adler. I'm sorry about the diagnosis, but this is what you have to do now. This was routine for Dr. Adler, who was running a tape he'd run many times before. Joanna put down her pen and wondered how this man could get up in the morning, have his coffee, and set out to play the Grim Reaper every day. We'll need a biopsy to confirm the cell type and the staging to see how far it spread. What about surgery, Joanna managed. Depends on how advanced the cancer is. I doubt it will be an option. I'll recommend an oncologist, and she'll prescribe medical treatment. My guess is that it's at a point where there can be no remission. It's all about stabilizing it at the original site. There are certain protocols. It's a matter of your oncologist opting for a better outcome or quality of life, but I'll leave that for her. You're damn right you will, Joanna wanted to say. We don't like your conjectures. As though someone had snapped fingers, Marco emerged from his trance. So what now? Dr. Adler's last statement had escaped him. There'll be more scans of your body to see how far it spread. Marco's last defenses crumbled. He had no more bravado. Well, I see. He's okay? The chest was clear? Myra asked Joanna. No, Ma. Oh. The couple left the office arm in arm, their gait slowed by a decade. Dr. Adler held Joanna back. The age, of course, is a double-edged sword. The cancer grows more slowly, but the organs are weaker, function less efficiently. They can put up with only so much treatment, she nodded. You need to make plans. It's clear that your mother is incapable. Of course. Her father was the caretaker, the keeper of the pills and the appointments. He was his wife's chauffeur, delivery boy, and personal shopper. From a plastic rack on the wall, Dr. Adler removed a pamphlet with a list of names and numbers and chanted another litany. Visiting nurses, in-home care, Catholic charities, hospice. Hospice? Not yet, but you'll need to be thinking about it. Does he have a living will? Yes. Get it to me. Joanna carried her resentment for this little man in the long white coat with the big name tag out to the enormous parking lot. There she stood without the faintest notion of where she'd park. It's way down the third row over there, Marco pointed to his left. I don't think so. Joanna, I'm telling you, it's down there. He was right, of course. And the fact that his memory surpassed hers terrified her. Or was it that she couldn't go through it all again? A funeral, an adjustment, the emptiness only 4 years after having lost Jill. 20 years from now would still be too soon. And then there was her mother to worry about. Joanna's father might have just been handed a death sentence, yet the person she felt sorriest for was herself. Well, it's been a good run, Marco said, breaking the silence on the ride home. He stared out the windshield. He saw nothing. It's not over, Dad. We'll get a second opinion. The flatness of their voices bounced words between them like a ping pong ball hit in slow motion. My father used to say that if you're afraid to die, you don't deserve to live. Listen, Joanna, he whispered now to make absolutely sure his wife couldn't hear. What's she gonna do? She can't manage alone. You don't know the extent of it, how I cover for her, what I hide from everyone. Gets worse and worse every day. I don't care for myself, but what's she gonna do? You know I'll take care of her, but Dad, it's not the end. There are other specialists and treatments besides. It's never really over. No, no, he shook his head. Don't start that. I don't believe in any hereafter, if that's what you're getting at. What happens to us when we die? We go into the ground period. That's it. That's it for all of us. I don't believe in that kind of hereafter either, Dad. You know I stopped believing a long time ago. But I do believe, I know the spirit lives on in another form, another body. And what if it does? Is that spirit going to cook for your mother? Is he going to put toothpaste on our brush in the morning? Is he going to kiss her goodnight? He was getting worked up now, his voice growing louder, and Joanna feared that soon her mother would demand to have their conversation explained to her. And Joanna would lose it then. She'd have to pull over to the side of the road and break down at the sadness of it all because she could feel the weight of emotion in her throat. Though he disregarded his feelings at times, Marco was not an ignorant or an insensitive man. The color had drained from Joanna's face, and she blinked rapidly to see through tearing eyes. Her anguish touched him. He lowered his voice. You really think that about the spirit? I know so, she said, grateful for the opportunity to salvage her composure and eager to tell him about the little girl she'd met at Villa Foresta the year before, but she held back. There had been far too much shocking news revealed on this sunny day. You never told me whether you saw the owner of the villa, her father returned to the conversation, to her last trip to Italy, as though he'd read her mind. He was looking at her now, searching for an answer. The owners weren't there, but I know that they're from Naples and that they'd recently bought the villa from a New Zealand couple. He's dead. I knew it. Oh, I don't know if we're even talking about the same person, Dad. I just know that couple doesn't own the villa any longer. He would never have given up that place unless he had to. He had cancer, Marco coughed, but it was a cough of discomfort, an attempt to cover up a quivering voice that could barely speak the word that had taken on a life of its own inside his body. How do you know? He told me that day your mother and I stopped there while we were driving around the countryside. He was thrilled to have someone to talk English to, yet someone who also belonged to Italy. Sometimes two people just hit it off. We sat at his restaurant and drank wine for hours. Restaurant? There wasn't any restaurant when we were there. No one was there except a caretaker concierge cook all rolled into one. Thinking about the villa, she became animated. And he didn't tell you about Harlan? He cleared his throat of phlegm and turned toward the back seat. In the rearview mirror, Joanna saw what her father was looking around to confirm. Myra's eyes were closed. Her head rested on one side as her lips muttered sleep garble. No. A dynamic man, very tall, strong, good-looking, engaging. He became more excited with each word, and Joanna could swear her father was smitten with this person. She never heard him pay this kind of tribute to another man, let alone one outside the family. Worked for an international relief organization, traveled the world. He was passionate about rebuilding that villa. Didn't know a damn thing about construction, though. I knew he was all wrong about the pitch of those stairs, but I didn't say anything. Stairs are falling apart, cracked all over. Marco let out a roar of satisfaction. Figures, I knew that would happen. A stubborn man. Said he would finish that villa even if it killed him. Said he wanted to be buried there. He is, Dad, under those stairs. Joanna remembered the caretaker telling her that. He said he didn't want to die until he saw his son kick his drug habit, too. He was a real fighter. Did you see the son? Joanna was quick to ask. Nah, he was in New Zealand at the time. They came and went. They all did. Joanna hesitated to tell her father what she was about to reveal. But in view of the news he had received and the story he'd just shared, he was more vulnerable than she had ever seen him, and she needed to tell him. She couldn't think of him leaving this world without knowing. I met a little girl at the villa, Dad. You're going to think this is crazy. Her mother is a cleaning woman. The caretaker said her father was a drug addict, the owner of the villa's son. Dad, I believe she's Jill. Like a cowering puppy, expecting to be reprimanded with a smack on the head, she waited for her father's reaction. So that's why you believe. That's what all this reincarnation talk is about. Yes. What makes you think it was Jill? She was born 3 days after Jill died. She was playing with a miniature horse. You know how much Jill loved horses. She even looked like Jill. Dad, it's like you said about Harlan being dead. I just knew. And Elliot? My husband is a man of science. You weren't kidding when you came home and said you had a good trip. Joanna couldn't contain the smile that broke over her face. The day I met him, Marco said we sat and talked until dark. I had taken your mother back to my brother's to rest. You know how easily she gets tired. I went back to the villa that evening by myself. There was something about the guy. We came from different parts of the world, but we got along so well, and I had the feeling that maybe we'd met before, but of course we hadn't. I guess I saw a little of myself in him, for better or worse. What do you mean? I know my strengths, Joanna, and my weaknesses. I know my fears have led me to walk a straight line in my life, be precise, follow through. But I'm also aware of how inflexible they've made me. I like to be right. Actually, I think I am right most of the time. You're right more than you're wrong, Dad. But you are wrong sometimes. She really wanted to know if something intimate had happened between her father and this stranger, but there was no way to ask. So how did you leave each other? Did you agree to keep in touch? We never talked about that. It wasn't a subject. It was only that day. And if another time happened to us, if I had been lucky enough to get in another trip back to my homeland, maybe I would have tried to find him again. Maybe. Some things are better left alone. They aren't meant to be built on. They are what they are. Ay, capito? She said she understood, even though her father had just spoken of a man as he might an exotic woman with whom he'd had a tryst, a lover who had opened up a world of mystery so profound that their ramifications were too overwhelming to speculate about. She said she understood because that's what you said to her father when he asked that, because he wasn't really asking. He was ordering you not to rock the boat, to leave well enough alone. He was closing a door, and there was to be no more knocking on it. That was how he dealt with his fear, and that was why she now knew for certain that he had never before spoken about the owner of the villa. Joanna glanced into the rearview mirror. Her mother was still dozing. Her father continued to process the notion that his granddaughter lived on and the granddaughter of a man with whom he seemed to have been infatuated. Had it been any other man, her father would never even have entertained the idea, but that it might be this man gave it some validity, and suddenly he did the extraordinary. He opened the door again. I had a dream last night, he confessed. I never dream, you have to understand. At least I don't remember my dreams if I do. But last night, I went back to Italy, back to the villa. He and I were sitting on the terrace, looking at the vast sky and those green hills, and I kept telling him that I thought I had cancer, too. We were speaking in Italian in my dream, although he didn't really speak Italian. He was speaking beautiful Italian. He never looked at me. It was like I wasn't there. I finally threw up my hands and cried out, why me? Why me? Ma perché? Answer me, goddammit. That's when he turned and looked at me as though I was crazy and gave me my answer, which was, why not, he said, as smooth and cold as ice. Why not? But it wasn't him talking. It was me, Joanna, me and his body that I watched creep back into the villa with all the humility only a dead man is capable of possessing. You think he came to you, Dad? Her father grew somber again. Death was no longer an entertaining guest among them. Staring blankly out the windshield, he struggled to shrug the deflated shoulders that had once carried Joanna and that so long ago she thought were mighty enough to carry the world. I don't believe in coincidence, Dad. I believe that this man came to you to help you, just as I believe that his little girl was his granddaughter and yours. That her father did not refute her statement was the best he could do, the closest he could come to acceptance. Suddenly, none of it seemed of much importance to him. Not Harlan and their relationship. Not even the fact that Jill might have been reincarnated. He was far beyond that. His brittle morning anxiety had given way to stoic calm. The secret was out. The greatest mystery of his life solved. Marco had crossed over to join those who know what everyone longs and yet fears to discover. The end to his story. Myra, we're home. Wake up, dear, he tenderly called to his wife. Already? That was so quick. All that talking you two were doing put me to sleep. We were speaking about Harlan Greenwood again, he said. Isn't he the weatherman on Channel 4? Marco gave an exhausted sigh of compassion for his wife as he looked over at Joanna, and their knowing eyes locked in an embrace that erased all fears and their demands, at least for the moment. Why not, dear, he told his wife, his gaze still fixed on his daughter. Why not? Thank you.
Be sure to tell you that Marisa's books are here. They're up there. She's willing to sign them.
And on sale.
On sale. Yeah, they're at bargain prices. So if you're interested, see her after the meeting. And now we're going to hear from Karen Osborne. Karen is the author of four novels, Patchwork, a Notable Book of the Year award from the New York Times, Between Earth and Sky, The River Road, and Centerville, which is the winner of the Independent Publishers Gold Award in Fiction. She's received fellowships from the Kentucky State Arts Council, the Kentucky Foundation for Women, and the Virginia Center for the Creative Arts. She was the recent Louis D. Rubin Writer in Residence at Holland University, and she teaches fiction writing at Mount Holyoke and for Fairfield University MFA's program. And poets and writers described Osborne's approach in Centerville as restrained ruthlessness, and as violence intrudes our everyday lives with sickening frequency, I can't imagine a more relevant story.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me and for coming. It's great. I'm going to just read a little bit from Centerville, and Centerville is based on an event that happened when I was growing up in a small town in the Midwest. So it's a fictionalized account, but it's based on an incident that I remembered from my childhood. And this is, I'm going to read you from the opening of the book first, and then just a short chapter. This is August 1967. Can you hear me okay? Is mic working? Okay. On Main Street, sunlight fell through the four large windows that made up the storefront of Greenlee's drugstore. A golden haze moved through the store, spreading like liquid poured from a gigantic cup, as George Fowler carried a brown paper sack inside and stood next to a display of birthday cards. The display was set up on a tall, narrow rack that could be rotated to view the different choices. His wife, Joyce Fowler, a cashier, had just finished straightening it. At the back of the store, Carlton Greenlee, the store's owner, sorted through cardboard boxes. He just sent Al Freeman, the store's pharmacist, across the street to get some lunch, which meant the pharmacy was temporarily closed, and he was working at the back alone. George Fowler leaned down, and a flash of light from the windows slid across his shirt as he placed the paper sack on the floor. It was an innocuous-looking brown bag, the sort of customer might have left behind. There was a new crease at the top where he had pressed the two sides together of the bag, the two sides of the bag together, and folded them over so they would stay shut. The bag sat on the gray linoleum, slightly rumpled in the afternoon light. He straightened, looking oddly calm, and left the bag on the floor. It took a few minutes for the paper bag to be discovered. Stella McNeese had come into the store on a sudden impulse that struck her as she left the bank. As she walked toward a display of journals and notebooks, she paused, staring at the sack. "What's this?" she said, bending down to pick it up. "Someone's left this." Bruce Watson had come into the store on his work break because he needed cigarettes. He had decided to get a candy bar as well. When he heard Stella, he was standing in front of the candy shelf, vacillating between a Baby Ruth and a Three Musketeers bar. "What is this?" Stella McNeese asked a little louder. He glanced up then and saw her lifting the paper bag. He heard the sound that seemed to be coming from inside the bag, a slight sound that blended with the other sounds inside the store so that it was hardly noticeable. "Don't," he said instinctively. "Put it down. Don't touch it." She bent over and placed it back on the floor, afraid now. "Where did it come from?" he asked. "Who set it there?" An employee, Billy Sandler, rounded the aisle on his way to the back of the store to see if the delivery truck had come yet. Behind him was Davy Sandler, Billy's cousin, who was a year younger and had been working at the store for only a few weeks. "Mrs. Fowler's husband was carrying a bag like that," Billy said. "He was here?" Joyce straightened up from the shelf and walked around to the aisle where the others stood. "When?" "Just a few minutes ago," Billy told her, nervous at the accusation in her voice. "I didn't say anything. I mean, I figured he has a right. What was he doing here?" She spoke the question as a demand. Billy stepped back, not answering her. Joyce had left George a month before. A few weeks ago, a box had arrived at her sister's duplex where she was staying. When she'd ripped away the packing tape and pried open the cardboard, she'd found strips of cut material. Passing her fingers through them, she'd realized the pieces of rayon and cotton were from the dresses she'd left hanging in her closet. Bruce Watson knelt down on the floor listening. The sunlight seemed to gather around him and he felt suddenly warm. "It sounds like a bomb," he said, his voice strangely matter-of-fact. He pressed the edge of the paper bag between his thumb and forefinger, gingerly opening it. "It's a bomb," he said louder. Deborah Gregory looked up from the soda fountain where she worked. Her younger brother sat at the fountain with his two friends drinking Cokes while their mother got her hair done across the street. Carlton Greenlee looked up from a box he'd just opened, uncertain of what he'd heard. "A what?" he called. "A bomb," Joyce Fowler and Bruce Watson yelled at once. "Oh Lord," Joyce added, "George has brought in a bomb." Carlton set down the box. It was filled with aspirin bottles, and as it tipped on its side, several bottles rolled out onto the floor. He stood watching them. Then, as the final bottle came to a stop, he was filled with a sudden decisiveness. "It could explode," Bruce shouted. "Throw it to me," Carlton yelled. He reached up his hands with an instinctive gesture. He wanted to get the bomb as far away from the store and the people as possible. "I'll throw it into the alleyway." A vacant lot stretched behind the drugstore and the business next door. If he pitched the bag hard enough, he could clear a sizable distance between the bomb and any of the nearby buildings. Bruce curled his fingers around the top of the bag and slowly straightened, lifting it from the floor. Stella McNeese moved quickly toward the door, but Joyce Fowler froze, watching him. She expected the bag to be heavy, and the effortless motion of Bruce Watson's back as he raised it from the floor surprised her. Bruce stretched his arms overhead and snapped back his wrists as his hands released their grip and the paper bag sailed through the air. It was an excellent throw, made with the overhanded ease of an outfielder. The bag cleared heads and the racks of merchandise, narrowly missing one of the light fixtures. Because Bruce secured the top of the bag with two additional folds, none of its contents dropped as it skimmed along the ceiling. Carlton Greenlee held his hands up. There was a millisecond as the bag seemed to hang suspended in the sunlit air above him, and then he caught it. He tightened his hands around it, feeling the crinkle of the paper between his fingers as he brought it down, cradling the bag against his chest, his body pivoting toward the rear of the store. He did all this automatically, a surge of power filling him. "Yes," Bruce breathed out, raising his arms in an involuntary sign of victory. And then the bomb exploded. Behind the soda counter, Deborah saw the explosion, but her mind didn't keep pace, so she didn't know what had happened. What she saw was actually two explosions happening within seconds of each other. The sudden bright flash of the bomb, followed by the burst of flames as the gas line at the back of the store ignited. She stood staring in surprise as her brother and his two friends turned into three columns of fire. Inside the flames, she could still trace the outlines of their faces and bodies. This seemed a strange thing, and then she looked down and saw that her own body lay on the floor, covered with flames. Glass from the Coke bottles littered the floor. She wanted to go and search out the broom and dustpan and sweep it up. The linoleum countertop curled as it melted. Joyce Fowler was staring at Bruce Watson when the bomb exploded. Somewhere in her mind, she knew the danger of throwing an explosive, but between the discovery and the pitch, she hadn't thought about that. Instead, she'd been filled with an odd sense of hope and even assurance that Carlton could throw the bag into the alley before it detonated. Now, both she and Bruce were quickly engulfed by the fire that followed. Bruce turned and looked at her, first with alarm, then with a look of kindness. "Sorry," he seemed to be saying with a shrug of his shoulders, and she felt her own apology well up inside her. George had meant the explosion for her, but now it would kill all of them. Stella McNeese at the front of the store heard the explosion behind her and felt the great suck of air as her body was thrown from the building. Billy and Davy had begun to run through the front door as the paper bag sailed over the aisles, and they heard the smashing of glass as the large windows exploded. It seemed to them that this was the main sound, and they weren't aware of any other sound, including the sound of the bomb going off or the roar of the fire. The explosion lifted them, carrying them toward the sidewalk. But before Davy reached a section of the ceiling crashed down, hitting the back of his head, and he lost consciousness. The light seemed to move through the storm more swiftly now, as if the flames fed it. Joyce Fowler saw it spreading like a giant web. "Hold on to me," the web seemed to call as she reached up out of herself. Carlton Greenlee hadn't heard or seen or felt anything. Bruce Watson had seen him make the catch and turn his back. He had watched Carlton turn into the blinding light of the blast, a glow that hovered afterward like billions of iridescent particles. Within seconds, the building swelled with flames. They hissed down the aisles, lapping against the walls and shelves. In the center, the flames burned white. Along the edges, they flickered yellow and red. The flames rose higher, ingesting oxygen, feeding on anything in their path. The light spread over them, and in the roar and crashing, as the second floor dropped through the ceiling, there was the radiance of that light, like a chorus or the singing of angels. 2 miles away, Reverend Edwards, the minister of Centerville's Methodist Church, heard a sound like that of thunder. He glanced up from his desk. He'd been working on the next day's sermon. What he knew was this. Centerville lay tucked away in the heart of the country, bordered by the plains of the west on one side and the cities of the east on the other. In his 12 years at the church, the congregation had grown from 40 members to more than 100, and tomorrow morning they would fill the pews. When he heard the chords of the processional, he walked up to the front of the sanctuary. He would walk up to the front of the sanctuary and stand before them. He would read the words of the Old Testament and the Gospel, followed by his sermon. His service would celebrate the evidence of God on earth, and he had just finished reading a verse that he would use from Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had 6 wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, and the whole earth is full of his glory. Now he sat listening. The room was quiet. The only sound was the rattle of an electric fan and the whisper of tires against the pavement on the street beyond the window. Tiny seed pods had formed on the maple tree, and if he looked closely, he could spot one drifting toward the lawn, pale green and transparent in the light. Sunlight still danced across his desk, shifting into patterns of shade on the floor and walls. The minister shut his eyes, and when he opened them again, the paper in front of him seemed glaring white in the haze of the afternoon sun. So after this opening, we begin to move around the fire for about a third of the book, sort of seeing the fire from these different perspectives of these 4 different characters. One of them is the minister, and one of them is his daughter, who almost goes into the drugstore right before the explosion, but ends up a couple of buildings down. And one is a firefighter, and then I'm going to read you a short chapter from Elizabeth Greenlee's point of view, and she is the wife of the drugstore's owner, if you remember. This is chapter 3. A block from the drugstore, Elizabeth Greenlee was lifting her 3-year-old daughter, Izzy, into the back seat of her car. The car was a new, dark blue Oldsmobile station wagon with a silver luggage rack on top and an optional third seat in the back that her husband, Carlton, had recently bought for her. For several years after he'd taken the drugstore over from his father, the business had struggled, but now it was doing well enough that they could afford a second car. She had picked the station wagon out off the showroom floor, and Carlton had signed the papers agreeing to the terms of the loan. Then she had driven it home, and he had followed behind in their old sedan. Now she didn't have to drive him to the drugstore early in the morning just so that she could have a car, and they had a larger vehicle to take on vacations. She wanted to drive south this year during the kids' spring break and stay in one of those small cottages on the coast of Florida, the kind tucked among a few palm trees next to the water, so that she could walk out the door and look at the ocean and feel as though she was at the edge of something enormous. Years earlier, before any of the children were born, she and Carlton had made that trip to Florida. It had reminded her of the northern coast where she'd grown up, except that Florida was a softer, warmer version. After just a few hours, the sound of the waves breaking against the sandy shore had become the only thing inside her head. 9 days, that's all it would take, she told Carlton a few nights ago after supper when they were sitting alone at the table. 2 days to drive there, 2 days to drive back, and 5 days we could spend on the beach. You can be away from the store for 9 days. Your father can look in on things, and Al Freeman could take over as general manager. We haven't taken a vacation in 6 years. Responsibility comes with ownership, he'd replied doubtfully, as if owning something made you less able to do what you wanted. Now, as she slid into place behind the steering wheel, she inhaled the smell of the new upholstery and heard the crackle of the vinyl. Her hair was pulled back with an elastic band, and she wore comfortable shorts and a sleeveless shirt. She'd gained weight since this last pregnancy, and the seatbelt rode up against her abdomen. Behind her, Izzy leaned forward over the back seat and slipped her hands around her mother's shoulders. Mommy, I'm a kitty, she purred into her mother's ear. Elizabeth reached back and rubbed her daughter's soft head. The blonde hair that fell to Izzy's shoulders was straight and as easy to tangle as the silk on a corn cob. All right, kitty, sit back into the seat and buckle your seatbelt. Do kitties know how to do that, she said. Mm-hmm, her daughter hummed into her ear. Then she felt Izzy slide away and heard the reassuring click of the seatbelt. It was another reason she had wanted the new car. Their other car only had seatbelts in the front seat. Now, if there was an accident, the entire family had protection. Meow, Izzy murmured. Pet me. Not right now, Izzy. Mommy has to drive. Elizabeth peered through the windshield as she started the car, squinting from the glare. The station wagon hadn't come with air conditioning, but the dealer had said he could install it under the dashboard. She told Carlton she didn't need the air conditioning, but now, in the sweltering heat, she was reconsidering. Earlier, when she was inside the post office talking with Janet Fitzpatrick, she'd heard what she thought was thunder. Two of the boxes stacked behind Janice awaiting pickup had fallen, and the overhead lights had blinked and trembled. Since then, there had been the sound of sirens. We're supposed to get a doozy of a storm, Janice Fitzpatrick had said. I heard about it on the radio. They said we could get as much as 6 inches of rain and hail. They're predicting hail. A dark cloud rested low in the sky in the direction of downtown. Elizabeth hoped to finish her errands before the rain started. She planned on stopping at the hardware store next to pick up more tiles for a birdbath she was covering as a crafts project. Now, as she prepared to leave the parking lot, she turned on the radio, anxious to get news about the storm. 2 years ago, a tornado had touched down in one area of the town, damaging half a block of buildings. Slipping the new car into drive, she felt the sure shift of the gears. The hardware store was located two buildings down from Carlton's drugstore, and she told herself she would stop to see him after buying the tiles. She drove to the exit, prepared to turn onto Main Street, but the steady stream of traffic meant she had to stop, waiting for an opening. Bits of powder drifted down from the sky, swirling toward Earth, looking oddly like scattered flakes of snow. For a moment, she simply watched them. Then one of the flakes landed on her windshield, and she saw that it had a ragged, unsymmetrical shape. And then she realized the flake was ash. Thank you.
Marisa, will you come up for a question of the mayor?
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah. Do you need some water? Like some water?
Sure.
So, responses, questions? Heather.
Karen, or both of you, I was wondering if you could tell us about that, our specific approach to it.
This is the first time I've ever done this. I don't know if I would do it again. I was fairly young when this happened, around 10, and I guess I was actually around 9 or 10. Anyway, I hadn't thought about it in a long time when I started to write it, and I think that was a good thing because it felt pretty distant from me. But it was interesting because it had become part of sort of my mythology and sort of my emotional life without me realizing it, because throughout my adult life I had had these dreams every now and then of being in a fire. And I actually ended up in this fire for a while, and I was in a nearby building, and was with a friend whose father was in the fire, who actually ran into the fire. So it was very chaotic for a long time. The whole town was had a hard time responding. It was a very small town, and they had to wait for more fire trucks to come from other towns. It pretty much took all day for this fire to be put out. And it was a kind of a traumatic experience, I'm sure, but I really didn't think about it that much. But I would have these dreams periodically where I would be in this fire, and kind of true to experience, there were sort of bits of fire everywhere. I always thought of it as hell when I had the dream. Oh, I was in hell again. But often in the dream, once I had children, I would be looking for one of my children, like, oh, one of my children would be in the fire. And then, I don't know, several years ago, it just occurred to me, I had that dream, and it occurred to me that I was actually the one in the fire. And I think that was what made me, I wrote that opening scene, and then I didn't do anything with it for a while, maybe another year or two. And then, by the time I went back to that scene, I was looking at it more as a fiction writer, and not so much from the angle of, you know, recreating my own experience. What I ended up doing, though, was sort of answering, I think, questions that I realized I had even as a child. It wasn't a connection I made until I was helping my parents get stuff out of their attic, and I came across this old diary of mine, and I had my questions written out as a kid, like everything that I wanted to know about this fire I had written down. And I realized, I was right in the middle of writing the book then, and I realized, oh, those are the same questions I'm answering in this. Primary among them was, why did somebody do that? Which is kind of a question a kid would ask, but I was also asking that as a novelist. And in the real incident, for example, the person who carried the bomb into the store was killed in the blast. And in the novel, I'm sort of giving you a little, this is a spoiler alert, but he's not. And I kept him alive, I think, to answer my questions. So there were a lot of things like that where I realized, oh, I was writing this story to answer questions.
What I can say is that I'd say in this novel, the latest novel, sometimes, as far as coming from place, a lot of the novel takes place in Western Massachusetts. So in that sense, I can be talking about place. It certainly isn't my experience at all. But I can draw from that place. As far as Thieves Never Steal in the Rain, the collection, on lost love and the supernatural, it's not about any particular place, but it's not about particular people, but it certainly is about the familial ties that I grew up with, still am involved with. So the people are not the same, the situations are not real, but it just encompasses a familiar love and an ethnic connection, but that's about the extent of that. I think that in and Stay With Me, Layla was a novel that did draw on certainly where I grew up, and while, and while again, the story was not real, nothing whatsoever happened to these people that, to the people I know, and the people themselves were not real. Some of them were composites, of course, but the people I knew, but the main characters were not real. But it was something that I, probably the closest I could come to writing about home. I wanted to memorialize the people that I knew, the people I knew at a time, from their time coming to this country, after the war, for that period of 25 years. And I just really felt this obligation and need to memorialize these people. So while they're not the same exact people, but the people in place, that is close to where I came from. I don't know if that answers it.
Anybody else? Questions or responses?
Marissa, how did you encounter the story that you said the book was based on?
Which the
small.
Yeah, because I was actually working in a women's recovery program on a volunteer basis and wanted to do really take it with these women. It was a residence program, and see offenders as offenders, and I wanted to put a face on these women. I found it absolutely intriguing, intimidating, frightening, and I didn't want to write something I didn't know what, and I was given permission to get close to one woman, and as I did, this amazing story came forth. I mean, even though this isn't a fictionalized account, but still there is a thread of reality running through it. And I, it really was proving my point that they certainly did have stories behind these faces. Only makes you want to know more of what each and every one does. I would hope that people do then think of that, what could be possibly behind, what is the history behind people who end up behind bars, people who end up in criminal situations. That's how I came to, but this woman took a long time to get any kind of story from her because of a compromised situation she was in herself and trust at a situation and all. But that's how I came to write it. It was a lot of research and a long haul that my husband was really happy over there when I was done. So it wasn't always a pleasant, things I was writing that you carry it with you 24 hours a day is all the way it was in you here. No. Leave it until you're done.
I've got a question. So in both of your work, turns on violence against women. There's a key moment, right? The bomber is bringing the bomb for his wife. Is an analysis of sexism important to you as you do your work? Do you put politics aside? Are you consciously trying to work out political issues? Or that's a question.
Well, for me, it was paramount.
Yeah.
And this book was paramount. That was a big factor of domestic abuse, violence against women. One of the many issues, but a paramount one that I wanted to hope that it opened eyes on, and that it's not restricted to third world countries, and it's not restricted to any socioeconomic level, that it crosses all lines, all ethnicities, all socioeconomic boundaries. And domestic violence is the greatest harm to women in our country between the ages of 15 and 45. I don't think people realize that the greatest harm comes from domestic violence. So that was definitely an intention of mine.
Yeah, I think that there, it's like as you said, you just said, it's realistic that, you know, as fiction writers, I think most of us are interested in what, you know, portraying at least a sense of what is real. In Centerville, the domestic violence sort of is simmering in the background, so it's not, doesn't emerge as like a primary issue. But yeah, I was definitely interested in being, and that was something that was true to the actual event that I had, that I felt was important. I think that in this book, what I got more and more interested in as I was writing it is sort of bigger questions about morality and the ways in which we all through our connections play our parts and become culpable to one extent or another. And so each one of the characters is sort of brought up against that in the next week after this bombing that occurs. So that's kind of the arc of the book that covers that week.
Interesting. Anybody else? Same, yeah.
I just want to know if you still have the dreams about the fire.
Oh, no, I do not.
After writing the novel?
Yeah, so I don't know. Like, I don't know if that was anything to do with writing the novel, but yeah, I do not.
Ask one more thing about writing about violence, and I'm not sure how to articulate it except for, did you find that particularly difficult to stay with the moments of that intensity, and sort of what was your process around bringing yourself to do it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, especially the scenes that later on do involve this killer, where there is violence or violence sort of in the background of it. Those are the hardest scenes to write, and I just, you know, my method was just that I just rewrote them over and over and over again to try to get it right. I also will say that I found it incredibly hard to get the characterization for George Fowler, who's the man who carries the bomb into the store. And I struggled with that up until the last minute. And in fact, right before sort of the final revisions of the book, I was, I initially had more chapters in here from the first point of view, but if you, read the book now, you see that there's just these little elliptical, very short, italicized pieces that are the elliptical and a little bit poetic kind of spread throughout that refer to him. So it's there's nothing real direct about him, although he does occur in some other character scenes. But before that, he had larger chapters. And I was taking a train home from, I'd done this big teaching stint down on Ender's Island for this graduate program, and it was like one of these three, it was like a 4-day, very intensive thing where I'd done a lot of teaching, and there was just been all this talking about process. And so I think I was kind of ripe for it, because I'm riding back, and I was kind of like paging through my manuscript, kind of, you know, trying to think about final revisions, because it was going and it was going to be printed soon, and it was going to go into final print. And I knew I didn't quite have that piece yet. And all of a sudden, it occurred to me that I couldn't, that it was wrong, like your normal instinct with a character is to try to know everything about them. And that was the wrong instinct with this character, and that really the only instinct there was with a character who was so violent was that I couldn't understand him. And it just made a huge amount of difference, you know, and then I realized sort of less was more, that that in order to make this character real, what I had to produce was that sense of confusion, of just utter amazement and disbelief, and not being able to really pin the character down. And so once I had that, I felt like I knew what to do with them. But it took a few years to get that.
Marissa?
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to write about anything that you don't embrace with passion, right? Passion about it and really make it jump off the page. And violence is, of course, really difficult. I think getting yourself in that, I read a lot about, I had to read into the psychology of abusers, before I could, and victims, before I could, begin to write about something like that to make it real. And it's difficult, very difficult, because it's not something you'd like it to go away. You don't want it to be. You're bringing out something that we hope doesn't exist, but it does exist. And then you have to get into these characters, when you start looking at him and him, and then you start feeling, the paranoia and the feelings, because then you're really there, you're down there with the situation.